Divorce lawyers of Reddit, what are some of your most memorable cases? Had a client whose soon-to-be ex-husband used her email address and phone number to sign her up for every bank, loan, religious mental illness, and pornographic site he could think of. She was bombarded by people contacting her about her interest in their products/services. He even put out ads for 6 partners on Craigslist with her information. The kicker is that she actually went out with a guy who contacted her. If I learned anything being a divorce attorney, I no longer practice. It was that if the opposing party sounded like a nutcase, I would soon see the nutcase come out of my own client. Normal people don't just accidentally marry crazies. Not often. Worked as courtroom clerk/front desk when I was in college. A couple argued on the custody details on their son. I thought it was the normal "I won't let you see him, you piece of shit," but the mom wants the dad to spend more time during holidays together, all 3 of them, and the dad wants to do the same, just more frequently. They ended up reconciled and agreed to couples therapy before the divorce procedure went further. Then they came back a month later to withdraw the divorce proceeding. Case 1. Honduran couple came in for divorce consult. I informed them I could only represent and advise one of them, and wife called first, so I'm representing her. He furiously storms out. 2 days later, he hides in the bushes outside the house where she is staying. When she leaves to go to work, he jumps out and decapitates her with a machete. 2 small kids in the house. Terrible sheet. Case 2. On the day of a divorce trial involving adultery grounds, opposing counsel produces photos of my male client, the husband, wearing lingerie and long brown wig, blowing another dude. I successfully exclude this from evidence on the grounds of relevance, because the wife was the photographer. Had a husband and wife go toe-to-toe over an ashtray they got in Vegas at some point. Neither smoked, strangely enough. Spent nearly $5,000 for me and another attorney to duke it out in court over the silly thing. Prior to proceeding, I explained what the cost would be for to argue over something silly like this, and that he could give me $2,500 and I would fly to Vegas for the weekend and get him an identical one instead. He said he didn't care about the costs because he intended to smash it on the courthouse steps in front of her if we won. We won and he followed through with the smashing. He laughed and said the look on her face was worth much more than $2,500. People get crazy in divorce proceedings. Worked for a family law lawyer in Santa Cruz. One of her frequent opponents, a decent, if aggressive, lawyer, just down the street, got a package bomb wrapped like a Christmas present. He picked it up, and it blew up in his face. Blew off most of his fingers, and left shrapnel in his face and chest. Last I heard, he dropped out of the legal profession. Happened on Christmas Eve in 1996. I worked for a law firm while in college, and we had a client who had just come home from a 2-week vacation with his wife, only to be served with divorce papers and a temporary restraining order as soon as they pulled in the driveway. Wife didn't say a word and just went into their house. Poor guy came straight to our office and was massively confused, to say the least. Husband and wife still living together at the time, had a small confrontation. The husband pulls a sphincter, says what on her, and she takes the bait and says what. He giggled like a little kid. She then told her lawyer, who had to talk to his lawyer. His lawyer asked him if he called his wife a sphincter, and told him he's not allowed to call her that anymore. My brother is a divorce attorney. His most memorable case, he was representing a guy in a divorce custody battle who was accused of horrific child abuse. Very graphic, very detailed depositions from the young kids against daddy. Things look grim. Then my brother, a failed actor, notices the deposition transcript, done by social workers under oath, contains a question at the end from one of the kids: did I hit my marks? He wonders how little kids know about acting jargon. Subpoena's wife's personal checking acts during discovery. Sure enough, acting lessons. Deposes an extremely sketchy acting coach, and panicked coach produces DVDs of practice interrogations with the kids. Hours of coaching the kids on exactly what imaginary things to say about daddy. He says it was his one and only Perry Mason moment in 20 plus years of practice, and dad got sole custody of the kids. The husband's statement of property listed all the food in the kitchen as of the date of separation. complete with estimated values for each item. Campbell's vegetable soup, $0. 79 feet. Yeah, but that's just OCD firing up. That kind of shit happens with some friends of mine, and not just because of divorces. An old roommate of mine would get the phone bill in the mail, immediately open it, divide up all costs, even separate out all long distance charges. Divide the cost of the stamp to mail the check, write the check, mail the check, and leave post-it notes and voices for everyone else involved, all within 5 minutes of opening the bill. It wasn't really a bad thing actually. One of my all-time favorites is the https://articles.latimes.com/1999/nov/17/news/mn34537. I'm not connected to the case, but it was a notorious case that resulted in a published California Court of Appeal opinion, which means that all the details are public record. Denise Rossi won $1.3 million as part of a group of co-workers who joined a lottery pool together. 11 days later she filed for divorce and moved out. She never mentioned the winning lottery ticket to Thomas. She also did not disclose the proceeds as either her separate property or as community property during the divorce. And she would have gotten away with it too, if it hadn't been for the letter that was sent to the marital residence over 2 years after the divorce had been finalized. The letter was an offer to buy out Denise's lottery annuity with a lump sum payment. Thomas promptly lawyered up, and the family court awarded 100% of the prize proceeds to Thomas. For the legally curious, please understand that California is a community property state, which means, among other things, that all earnings during marriage are community property that is owned equally by both spouses. Anything obtained using community property funds, like a lottery ticket, is also community property. There are also heavy penalties for violating the disclosure requirements that come along with a divorce in California family law matters. You must disclose all of your assets to the other side, even if there is no question that some of the assets are your separate property. In any case where a party to a divorce fraudulently conceals a community property asset, as with the Rosses, it is mandatory under Family Code Section 1100 for the court to award 100% of the asset to the other party, and orthograph penalties can also be applied. For the legally nerdy, the case citation is 90 calories. App 434 http://caselaw.findlaw.com/CAC Court of Appeal/1072229 HTML. 20 plus year divorce lawyer here. I've seen it all. I once represented a husband divorcing his wife of 35 plus years. They were in their late 60s. At mediation they divided up about $500,000 in assets within 30 minutes. Then they spent 2.5 hours fighting over 2 hurricane glasses from Pat O'Brien's and a pitchfork. Mediator: she really wants that pitchfork. It was a gift from her daddy. Husband: that beach. We bought it at Home Depot 2 years ago. And etc. They settled at mediation, after spending over $1,000 in attorney fees combined for the glasses and pitchfork. They remarried 3 months later. My first client was in an abusive relationship. Her soon-to-be ex told her she wasn't going to get a dime in support, would text her terrible things about how he would never pay, ended up getting her a sizable support order for her and her children. I remember the last thing I talked to her about was that she was so happy she finally took control of her life. A few days later I got a call from opposing counsel asking if I would consent to terminate the support order. I ask, why would I do that? Turns out she passed away in her sleep the day prior. Heart issues that she suffered from 4 years. Postscript: opposing counsel, a relatively young guy, also passed away soon after. I think I might be the only survivor from that case. Also had a client who fought tooth and nail over cookie sheets. Perspective, I suppose. Edit, some corrections. My aunt has been divorced for quite some time. She drives her attorney crazy with her requests/demands. Most recently she took her husband to court over one. He switched the beneficiary of his life insurance policy from her, the ex-wife, to their children. 2. She wants court-ordered drug tests weekly. She found out from her friend, who works at a pharmacy, that he has had quite a few narcotic prescriptions, but obviously can't enter that into evidence, or friend will be fired. 3. Wants to know the days he's working and locations, so she can have her private investigator keep an eye out and make sure the new girlfriend isn't joining him at hotels he's charging on his work card. At some point, she just needs to let it go and move on. She got the house, and the house payments, the kids, the boat, and the Marriott points. He doesn't pay alimony or child support, so it seems like it worked out well. Not a lawyer, but as a courthouse clerk, I had a court order come across my desk that explicitly banned a father from playing Minecraft with his son over the internet because the ex-wife alleged that the in-game chat was a form of improper contact that wasn't outlined in their custody/visitation plan. My mom works in divorce court. She comes home with stories that are interesting, sad, funny, and sometimes just weird. It's what you would expect for the most part. Then there are the drug addicts that don't want to give up custody. The day of the drug test comes, and the person miraculously decided to shave their entire body. Tests are now given right after the judge asks for one. And some are hilarious when you are not the one involved. My favorite is, a voicemail is played in court as evidence. The wife is cheating on the guy. This voicemail is from the husband to the wife. Hey, I know you are there. The only reason you can't answer is because I know you can't speak with that guy's dick in your mouth. Sometimes my mom has those stories which are funny, if you are not involved. My client's husband cheated on her with another woman and he took some photographs of her, ahem, penetration. She found the pictures on the husband's computer, but his face was not in any of them. So during a deposition I had to ask him if the penis in the photographs belonged to him, and he said he wasn't sure. When I pressed him on why he could not identify his own penis, he claimed that exposure to Agent Orange in Vietnam caused him to have memory problems. I'm a real estate lawyer, but a friend of a friend is a divorce lawyer. I was once told a story where said lawyer was brutally attacked by a client's former spouse. Apparently the former spouse blamed the divorce attorney for taking him to the cleaners in the divorce. The worst part is that the lawyer was at the grocery store doing his weekly food shopping with his wife and kids when he was savagely beaten. Criminal lawyers work with the worst people on their best behavior. Family lawyers work with the best people on their worst behavior. Edit. Thank you, kind stranger, for my first Reddit gold. You Daryl MVP. I work for a mortgage company and occasionally we have to review divorce decrees if someone is divorcing to remove a spouse's name from the loan. There is a notorious case known around my pretty large department as the CAP divorce decree account. In this divorce decree, there is a 5-page addendum specifically regarding Mittens and Buttons Johnson, names changed for their protection. Memorable clauses included, mandatory 10-minute Skype sessions weekly, no unsupervised play dates with children under 15, and that their clause be trimmed every 3 days. Sounds like my friend's divorce. They ended up having to split up the Kittens, because the two of them couldn't agree on anything. He then moved back to Texas, or wherever he was from, and took the kitty with him, and my friend tried to stop him, citing that he was breaking their divorce agreement. And most of the fighting happened over Facebook, pre, during, and post-divorce. And yes, it was like a train wreck and I couldn't look away. And then she got engaged again, and the guy broke it off, and that was public on Facebook, too. Sweet, sweet free entertainment. That sounds so much like this couple. Some of the things on that list were so petty I almost felt bad for the lawyer who spent thousands of dollars and years of school to have to write, Mittens shall have no more than one serving of catnip bi-weekly and other equally stupid nonsense for his clients. Don't even get me started on Facebook. I have a huge family, and of the 10 or so cousins who have gotten married in the past 3 years, 4 are now divorcing. And their public relationship dramas are the opera glasses worthy well that never runs dry. Not divorce related but still interesting, when a local couple died, their will indicated that their house and sizable fortune would remain in trust, managed by family friends, until their several cats died of natural causes. The odd thing is, it's been over 20 years now, and the cats are still alive. Also, they've changed color. When I was an assistant DA, I was involved with a PFA, protection from abuse, proceeding for a divorcing couple. The allegation was that the husband sent his brother a Facebook message that said, "Somebody's about to get ray-riced. Looks pretty bad, right?" Well, both the husband and the brother get on the stand and explain that they were talking about their mother. They said that ever since they were kids, when their mom would yell at them, they would say she'd like, "Mom, you're about to get rock bottomed, or you keep it up, and you're gonna get a stone cold stunner." Mind you, these guys were, at the time of this hearing, in their late 20s. It was all I could do to keep from laughing. I was just picturing the kids from Teladagonites the whole time. I'm not a divorce lawyer, but when I was at a mediation a few months ago, the mediator was telling me about a divorce he mediated a few years back. It was your classic rich guy is sick of his wife and kids, and wants a divorce, to run off with a young hot piece of ass. His wife wanted blood. She came to the mediation with some pretty outrageous demands about the money and property she'd receive. The mediator pushed hard throughout a long day of mediation, but she hadn't budged an inch. Finally, very late in the day, the husband threw up his hands and said, "Duck it, give her everything she's asking for, and let's be done with it." The mediator went back to the wife's conference room to share the good news that the husband had caved in, and she flipped the duck out, glowing incandescent with rage at the idea that her husband was willing to pay truly insane compensation to be done with her and ride off with his little girlfriend. Divorce lawyer here. I've never had anything too crazy. The worst I can think of is representing my client who had to be transported from the jail for, allegedly, violating the restraining order between the two. There was another one that was technically a dissolution of domestic partnership, not a divorce, but essentially the same thing for never married parties, that was fairly crazy. Client alleged her ex had killed a man and reported it to the police, but I guess they never found the body. Also alleged his attorney was sleeping with him. One of my co-workers had a case where the ex was awarded the couple's dog in the divorce, only to have it euthanized just so the other would suffer more. I don't care how bad your relationship is, there is no excuse for that. That pissed me off to hear about. A friend who is a lawyer told me a pretty crazy story about a wealthy couple splitting up. The woman hid millions of dollars overseas and cut up all her husband's clothing with a pair of scissors. These shenanigans caused her to get almost nothing.